Thank you so much, Krista, and welcome everybody to today's CFR webinar, Another Year of Crisis, Assessing the Top National Security and Market Risks for 2021. As Krista said, today's conversation is on the record. I'm Carla Ann Robbins. I'm an adjunct senior fellow at CFR, and I run a master's program at Baruch College, CUNY. In another life, I was the deputy editorial page editor at the New York Times, and I covered diplomacy for the Wall Street Journal. Our two speakers today are my friends, and they really are my friends and colleagues, Paul Stairs, who is the General John W. Vessey Senior Fellow for Conflict Prevention and Director of the Center for Preventive Action at the Council on Foreign Relations. Paul's latest book, Preventive Engagement, How America Can Avoid War, Stay Strong and Keep the Peace, provides a comprehensive blueprint for how the United States can manage a more turbulent and dangerous world. Paul also directs the Council's yearly Preventive Priorities Survey, which we're going to be talking about today. And we're going to put into chat a link to the survey so you guys can see the results because it just is hot off the presses. Rob Kahn is the Director of Global Strategy and Global Macro. That's M-A-C-R-O, not the fish, at the Eurasia Group. That's right, isn't it, Rob? A global political risk and consulting firm. Rob's research focuses on macroeconomic policies and then transmission of shocks throughout the global economy. Rob has also been a senior fellow for international economics at the Council, a senior advisor in the financial policy department at the World Bank, and held senior staff positions at the IMF, at Citigroup, and was a senior economist at the Council of Economic Advisors and the Federal Reserve Board. Rob is a contributor to the Eurasia Group's annual top risk report, which we'll also be talking about this morning. So just a very quick overview of today's format. Paul, Rob, and I are going to chat for about 20 and 25 minutes. And then, as Krista said, we're going to open the conversation up for questions. Please raise your hand and we will call on you. And please try to keep your questions concise because I think, you know, we have a really large group here today and I think people are going to have a lot of really cool questions to ask. So Paul, let's start with you. Can you quickly tell us about the survey? Who was surveyed? How many people responded? I know I responded. And what you were looking for with this effort. And also just a few of the top line takeaways for this year. I see at the very top of tier one as ranked likelihood high and impact high is North Korea's further development of nuclear weapons and ballistic missiles. And right after that is another cheery thought, a collapse of the peace process in Afghanistan.
Well, thanks, Carla. It's great to be with you and Rob. You are indeed good friends of mine. And thank you everybody who's joined the call today. I really appreciate it. So as Carla said, this is the 13th annual survey that we've done. And just to sort of give you a quick background on what this is about, because I think it's important for the conversation we have, just so that there's no misunderstandings about how we interpret the survey's results. So it's basically a crowdsourced risk assessment. At the end of every year, we come up with 30 contingencies of discrete political military contingencies that we deem to be plausible in the coming year and moreover likely to be harmful to US interests. And we send out the survey. I think this year went to over 500 US foreign policy experts. And we asked them more or less to assess the likelihood of each contingency and their likely impact on US interests. And then we aggregate them into three tiers of relative priority, basically with the understanding that not every crisis is equally important and that we should prioritize where we devote our attention in trying to avert those crises or manage them and so on. And so, and just to be clear, the focus is very much on, as I say, discrete political military contingencies. We don't, look at the pandemic or economic crises or even civil unrest in America. Not that that would ever happen, of course. And so it's very much focused on external foreign policy crises. As you say, Carla, that the number one contingency or potential crisis that identified this year is a crisis involving North Korea, likely to be triggered by resumption of their nuclear weapons program or long-range ballistic missiles. It's quite interesting that that's gotten very little attention, it seems, by the incoming Biden team, to the extent that one can really divine their intentions, and which is a little surprising. And I think Last week's, Workers' Party Congress in Pyongyang seems to give some credence that we might be actually looking at a resumption of more tense relations with North Korea in the coming months. As you also say, there are other contingencies in the top tier that I think are worthy of attention by the incoming Biden team. Afghanistan is high up there as something that they're going to have to deal with. There's a deadline coming up in May of this year in which I think all US and NATO forces are to be withdrawn. And that's very much, I believe, conditions based on the progress of the peace process there. And so that could be a crisis. There's also, the still simmering situation in Iran, with Syria, which is another top tier, as well as I think possibly the most interesting addition this year was Taiwan that made it into top tier. But anyway, I'd be happy to sort of go deeper as you wish, but they're certainly the headlines.
So I want to get on to Rob and the top risk report, but I did want to quickly follow up with that, and we can go into it more. Granted, in the campaign, and it was a very odd campaign, there wasn't a lot of discussion of foreign policy. So why do you think these words didn't cross the lips of the president-elect or any of his foreign policy advisors? Is it because they're not preparing for them, because they don't want to think about them? Are they the topics that need not be named because they're afraid they will happen if they talk about them?
Look, I think before the events of last week, the number one priority has been bringing the coronavirus pandemic under control. And they don't want to project any sense that they are somehow focused on other issues when, 3,000 to 4,000 Americans are dying every day. That just has to be the number one, number two, number three priority. And just talking about issues that seem very distant to Americans will just make them look as if they're completely disconnected from reality. Look, these are experienced folks coming in. They know the world intimately. And so that they, I'm sure, are aware of this. They're looking closely at many of these issues. And frankly, if they're honest with themselves, they should recall how when many of them were during the Obama administration, they were surprised by events like, the rise of ISIS, the Ukraine issue, the Ebola outbreak in West Africa. So they're sensitive about how things can come out of the left field and be a major distraction and be a major risk to their domestic agenda getting blown off course. So I hope they are sort of paying attention, looking a little ahead. The fact that Bill Burns is going to be the new head of CIA, I think, is encouraging. He he's very much aware about how things can come out of nowhere and really, really be a major issue.
I mean, it is interesting that North Korea topped the list with likelihood high and impact high. And that is one in particular case that if you don't talk about it, it has a tendency to get worse. I mean, this is, as you said, with the Congress and Kim, I mean, hissy fits are what happened when you don't pay attention to him. So it would seem to me that that's really something they can't afford to ignore. They're going to have to figure out at least some sort of public statements to respond to what he's doing.
Absolutely.
So Rob, top risk, the top risk report covers a much wider swath of topics than just national security. And your patch in particular is number 2 out of 10 on that list, what's called long COVID, and looks at the lasting effects of the pandemic, even if we all get shots in the arms. And the report says it predicts that there will be a legacy of high public debt, displaced workers and lost trust, sharply different rates of recovery, both within and among countries, which will stoke anti-incumbent anger and public unrest. And in addition, if that's not frightening enough, you're predicting that emerging markets could face a financial crisis. So with those cheery predictions, take it away.
Thank you, Carla. And also thank you, Paul, for allowing me to join you guys today and to join old friends at a CFR roundtable. And Carla, you've highlighted, I think, the critical elements. Before I jump into that, just sort of one overarching point would be to say that when we talk about risks at Eurasia, we're not really talking about events that are way out in the tail, but could have a major impact, you know, which touches on some of the elements Paul's touched on. We're really thinking about elements of our base case that are either well outside the consensus or have the potential to be destabilizing or challenging in critical ways. And so a lot of what we have in our risks this year really are coming out of the pandemic as a punctuated moment, you know, or as a triggering moment, an accelerant of longer term trends, creation of news. So like when we highlight US-China tensions intensifying, that's very much linked to the developments last year, and how that constrains the Biden foreign policy team coming in. Or when we talk about a cyber tipping point, obviously a response to recent events, but also a reaction to some of the sovereignty debates that we think the pandemic has made more acute. So that's kind of really infuses everything. But as you said, the one that is most up my alley and concern is this long COVID argument. And it started with reflecting on two points. One was the very sharp run-up in asset prices over the course of 2020, seemingly disconnected to our own sense, and presumably the sense of many people on this call, that the world is a very dangerous place these days. So is that a disconnect, or is it reflecting some different set of motivations and drama, you know, that these markets, and that markets are continuing to rise, even and seemingly undeterred by riots on the Capitol, insurgency plots and the like. And, you know, absolutely part of that was this extraordinary infusion of liquidity in the major countries, central banks in the fore, but also extraordinary fiscal policy action, which has sort of floated every market, including emerging markets that traditionally in these kind of, facing these kind of shocks would be almost instantaneously facing a crisis, where many were able to borrow for long periods at very low rates to finance these extraordinary demands they faced. And so we started by asking, well, is this going to be the same this year? Or is 2021 the year in which these pressures come to the fore? Markets would tell you that 2021 is going to be benign. And there are a lot of kind of people out in the market saying emerging markets, for example, are going to have a great year this year. We beg to differ. And it is this long COVID idea. First and foremost, we have to understand just simply the uncertainties associated with the vaccine rollout, effectiveness, getting them in people's arms that you touched on. Also that the difference of timing in all of the rollout of that. I was reading a report yesterday, for example, that most of Africa will not see vaccines until 2022. How do they feel about that in an environment of where the Western world is starting up again and may also, you know, be imposing travel restrictions on countries that aren't getting that? So the issues of the vaccine rollout have important elements in terms of across countries and also, of course, within countries. And I'll come back to a bit and presuming the discussion. So what people call the K-shaped recovery dilemma, the idea that even within countries, there is such this shock has had extraordinary disproportionate impact on different sectors of the economy, and the recovery will similarly be disparate in that regard. And that is a major political and economic challenge. So that's sort of half of the story. And the other half is this idea of scar tissue, that coming out of this, we shouldn't just assume that kind of once we get our shots, we all go back to normal or some version of a new normal in which we're all kind of doing the things we did before. There is going to be a legacy out of this pandemic, a legacy of extraordinary debt and insolvency, a legacy of lost jobs, lost connectivity to labor markets and lost skills, a legacy of political strains, particularly I think in many emerging markets where expectations are running ahead of what these countries can deliver. And so for political and economic reasons, we think that governments are going to face continued pressure. Now, I think some people from the markets will say, but Rob, you can finance that. countries will continue to just borrow, run extraordinary deficits, and it will be a problem for another day. I'm not so convinced, and we're starting to see what's going on. We're starting to see that in a run-up in U.S. yields and also differentiation across emerging markets in terms of the cost they can borrow. And as, for those of you who have lived through emerging market booms and busts in capital flows, you know that, you know, they take longer to happen than you expect, but then they come much quicker. And just as the inflow, the liquidity flow, you know, surge that, that kept all these problems under the surface last year was historic, so too the withdrawal could be historic. And we are increasingly concerned that the legacy of this scar tissue will be differentiation across countries, and that countries with weaker fundamentals and weaker political or more political and economic challenges will increasingly find it difficult to finance themselves and to deal with the challenges that they are being presented with this year. And so we see the risk of crisis coming out of that is pretty significant.
So I want to get onto one more round of questions before we go to the group, but I do have to have, being the journalist that I am, I do have to have a follow-up question here quickly. You know, having seen, you know, fast turnaround crises happen and how quickly they do, what's your prediction? I mean, it's, you know, what are the countries that are most at risk right now in the emerging market?
So I think that what we've said is that the canaries in the coal mine are emerging markets that have weak fiscal fundamentals and are very much dependent on markets. And so I would put in that category Brazil. We're still hopeful that the kind of the fiscal politics hold together, but it's very contentious. South Africa, which is seeing around roughly about 20% of GDP run up in debt. The politics are very difficult there on that regard. And I think the ability of the president to maintain fiscal discipline tough. And Turkey, where we've seen a sharp turn to orthodoxy, which markets have rewarded, but we expect that to be temporary. Developments in those countries matter. They are systemic across emerging markets. That said, if you ask me, you know, and I, as you know, Carla, I spent a lot of my time, my career working on debt crises. I think you also have an element of this is what countries are going to default. And there it's going to start with smaller countries. So far, we've seen that in low-income countries in Africa primarily, but I think in Latin America now, we're seeing growing financial distress. For many of these countries, going to the IMF is problematic. And increasingly, I think the official community, and this gets also to the views of the incoming Biden team, are going to look for private sector lenders to kind of contribute to rescue efforts when they can't finance themselves anymore. And so sort of there's a kind of overarching risk that we see a kind of 1997 or 1982, 84 style shock in terms of debt crises that kind of spread across the world, and kind of the willingness to pay, the ability to pay starts in the smaller markets and spreads out to bigger credits over time. And so it's kind of that two-tier, that two-handed, or I don't know how you call it, two sources of risk, the market vulnerable countries and then the heavily indebted countries that together are going to put a lot of pressure on the G20, kind of decide what the policy is. One last point here. And this is a little bit more sort of way outside the consensus, but something to watch. If you look, for example, at say Southeast Asia, also some of the larger emerging markets, many of them have corporates that have become extraordinarily indebted over the last year, are having increasing trouble financing themselves. But in many of those countries, those corporates, they're large national champions, operate as if they have the full backing of the government, right? And if for any reason, because of these kind of pressures we're talking about, a government like in India or in Indonesia basically says, I can no longer backstop you in the way I used to, that's gonna be another source of financial stress that could metastasize very quickly. It's not terribly transparent. It fits in with that view that a lot of the sort of scar tissue from the pandemic financially is sitting on corporate balance sheets that basically have become zombies, aren't able to cover their costs. But I think in a lot of these emerging markets, they kind of continue to borrow partly because of, you know, the arms of state banks get twisted, partly also because of that presumption that the state will always stand behind the telecom company or the electric company or whatever. If that changes in any way, that's a 1997 style shock which I think could get very bad very quick.
Thanks for that cheery thought. Yeah, no, that is really, and as you said, it could turn around so fast, particularly as governments that have had very open hands suddenly will find that they don't have such open, can afford, or also politically afford to have such open hands, or not having the international backing. So Paul, were you surprised in the survey by any shifts in American attitudes about what is important? Because I noted on the likelihood moderate, but only impact moderate list, three things that would grab my attention beyond the moderate impact. And certainly I think that when I voted, I would have put them on perhaps likelihood moderate, but holy crap, if it happens, it's really important. And on that list, I would put down the breakdown of disengagement agreements between China and India, leading to a military confrontation. Let's not forget they are both nuclear armed. A major terrorist attack or heightened unrest in Kashmir, triggering a severe India-Pakistan military confrontation, both nuclear armed. And then finally, heightened tensions between Israelis and Palestinians, leading to widespread protests and violent confrontation. And in that case, think about domestic political constituencies that, you know, that drive reaction there. You know, does this tell us that maybe the Trump era has really had a more lasting impact, including in the foreign policy lead in this country?
So I think they're interesting observations, and I'll just touch on them in a minute. I think looking back over the last 12, 13 years of these surveys, in which the initial years were very much dominated by kind of the post 9/11 agenda, over the last couple of years, we've seen that slip. So, you know, the risk of a mass casualty terrorist attack, kind of Al-Qaeda attack on the US, that's barely making tier one now, because it's seen, you know, it's gone from being, you know, relatively high likelihood to barely moderate likelihood. And but there are still clearly issues from that agenda, if that's the right way of putting it, like Afghanistan, like Iraq, and other that are still lingering out there, which the Biden folks will have to deal with. And you're also seeing clearly, you know, the emergence of a new agenda. You know, cyber didn't mention that, but that's clearly up there. It was the number one threat last year. As I mentioned at the outset, we're seeing Taiwan go from what was a second tier concern to a top tier concern this year, which I think, again, reflects this general unease about US-China relations. Sort of somewhat counterintuitively, though, a potential clash in the South China Sea, which I thought would have gotten a higher ranking this year, actually fell. Now, you know, was that some anomaly, or are respondents somehow judging that, you know, the US and China already understand what's at stake there and they're going to kind of keep things tamped down? I don't know. As for the three issues you mentioned, they're in some respects the dogs that keep kind of barking but don't bite in a really bad way, or at least they haven't recently. You know, we saw the flare up on the Sino-Indian border, and so, you know, as a latent risk, this has huge implications for the reasons you mentioned. But I think there's this presumption that somehow India and China will work this out and prevent it from escalating. India, Pakistan, this thing has been, you know, off and on for decades now. And again, I think there's a presumption here, this is how I'm reading the results, that somehow this is a crisis that both sides kind of know how to manage. There are bounds, there are parameters here. And the same goes for the Israeli-Palestinian, there seems a presumption there is upper limits to this. There will be low-level unrest and so on, but this thing is never going to really escalate badly. Now, you can question those assumptions, and, you know, every crisis is not a crisis until it is. And things can spin out very, very quickly and unpredictably. And so, you know, that's kind of how I'm reading this, that most respondents think that these are known knowns, as Donald Rumsfeld would classify them, and somehow, you know, folks understand it. I think what's possibly more dangerous, just because they're just a little more predictable, are the kind of outliers, the wild cards. And, you know, I was interested in Rob's sort of observation about, you know, what I would characterize as a kind of the triple whammy of, you know, COVID, low oil prices, debt stress. That is a witch's brew there that not only has market implications, but also sort of geopolitical implications or implications for unrest. And you could see that playing out in a number of very significant places. I was struck in the Eurasia report's reference to Algeria being at risk. There's also the issue of, you know, potential Saudi succession in Riyadh, and then there's, you know, Brazil, which Rob mentioned, and several people wrote into our survey, you know, pay attention to Brazil. Why isn't this on your survey? So to me, they're the ones that I think people probably are not paying enough attention to, and perhaps should actually be a little more wary about those scenarios.
So since I'm the moderator, I get to vote a second time for the one that I would have put higher on this, which is Russian interference or intimidation against a member of NATO. In fact, if I'm going to worry about something between now and the 20th, I'm absolutely amazed that the Russians haven't made a run for it. I mean, we have such a continuity of government issue going on right now. And, you know, it's the fact that nobody has taken advantage of the chaos that's going on is, to me, absolutely amazing. God willing, we get through the next few days, but it's what makes me nervous. I'm going to go to the question. I suspect people are going to have a lot of questions for both of you. Can attendees just please raise your hand? Let me know if you've got questions out there. People seem to be quiet today. Please.
Carla, while you're waiting, can I jump in on that Russia comment you just made?
Please.
Just two thoughts. I mean, we did try to get at it a little bit through our discussion of cyber. And obviously that's one of the catalysts for tension and conflict. But we do struggle with this a little bit. And, you know, it's not just what the Russians do, right? But it's also our own domestic dynamics. If you had asked me a month ago, it'll be interesting to hear people's thoughts in the group. But if you had asked me a month ago where the US was on Russia, I would have said it's down the list of incoming Biden administration. They obviously are concerned about US-Russia policy, but it wasn't going to be the first thing we were going to deal with. We had big issues with China, we have the, you know, and others. And that it would be something to come back to. I feel like in the last month, for a variety of reasons, obviously the hack first and foremost, but Navalny and others, in some sense, I sense a real shift even in Washington towards a sense that Russia has to be, we have to deal with this early on. And I wonder what others think about whether the potential for that becoming a destabilizing dynamic, even beyond cyber, in terms of sanctions and other kinds of, you know, tension between the US and Russia. So I raise it as a question, but it is something that we're kind of noticing and feel like there's been a material change even in the last month.
You know, I think you're right, Rob, if I can jump in. You know, this administration will, I think, have to decide pretty early on, you know, what kind of relationship do they seek to have with not only Russia, but obviously China. You know, this may sound like a self-evident thing to say, but, you know, with all the talk of, you know, new era of great power competition, the Biden folks really have to decide, you know, is this the kind of relationship, a adversarial, quasi-adversarial, potentially confrontational relationship with these two major powers? Do they want this? And is there an alternative to either, you know, accepting what they're doing and looking as if they're appeasing it, or going to the other extreme and being, you know, very confrontational, very robust in the response, and trying to find the balance there, I think is frankly going to be one of the, you know, the major questions that they have to address. You know, I liken it sometimes to, you know, are they going to flatten the curve of major power rivalry? You know, and this thing could, you know, really get very serious very quickly if they don't have a real basic understanding about what kind of relationship they want with both countries and what, frankly, what kind of relationship they can have. Obviously, you know, there's two sides of the negotiating table here, and but you know, it really does require some fundamental rethinking about where we're headed with regard to both countries.
Well, I would say just two things really quickly. One is that Biden has to, within 2 weeks, make a decision on extending New START, which is an easy thing. All he has to do is to sign the paper. He said he's going to do that. I think the point that they're going to make it that there is that you can do lots of different things in a relationship as we did in the Cold War. And it is in our interest to extend New START. It's the last remaining arms control treaty. They took a very hard line on this enormous, you know, SolarWinds hack. But I think there's a legitimate argument to be made that we're probably doing the same thing in a pretty effective way out there. And the distinction between, you know, infrastructure attacks versus, and I don't know how extensive this is. I'm not sure anybody knows how extensive this is. It's obviously a massive intelligence failure on our part. But, you know, is it spying versus is it a really a core attack on, you know, on our infrastructure? There's some really pretty big questions to be had there. On the other hand, you know, the Russians are breaking every norm out there. They're using chemical weapons. I mean, this is a very complex relationship that they're going to have to figure out how to do. And Biden's been very good about talking tough on Russia, but now he's got to figure out how to have a more textured relationship.
Exactly.
I see Ariel Cohen, I'm sure, has some very strong opinions on this too. So Dr. Cohen, please, you will be unmuted. Please ask your question. Looking forward to it.
Okay, can you hear me?
Absolutely.
Wonderful, thank you so much. Fascinating discussion. I'm particularly taken by the discussion of possible contagion from the emerging markets into the OECD markets, especially into the US and Europe. And after all, the majority of these participants probably have their life savings one way or another in this market. So if you can expand on contagion, but back to the threats, one question about Russia is how Russia is going to conduct its operations in Ukraine and Belarus. I think before we're worried about NATO, I don't think Putin is really going to provoke in the last week of the Trump administration anything vis-a-vis NATO. But Belarus going forward is a fascinating case because we don't have a NATO instrumentality or guarantees there. And another question is about Iran. Iran wasn't mentioned, but there are reports about Iran getting closer to the warhead development and also the friction between Israel and Iran in Syria and in the future, possibly Lebanon. Do you mind talking a little bit about how the return to JCPOA may temper the Iranian behavior throughout the Middle East, Yemen, Iraq, Lebanon, Syria, et cetera? Thank you.
Thanks.
Should I take a crack at that, Carla?
Go for it.
So thank you, Ariel. All good points. Just briefly on Ukraine, interestingly, I think Ukraine was in top tier last year, went down to tier two this year. That could be considered somewhat surprising. I think, again, this sort of presumption that this is a more or less a frozen conflict now and Russia would not want to stoke things or destabilize things even further. Belarus did make it on the survey this year. I believe it's either tier two or tier three. And so there is concern that you know, that's, I think, in the wild card category of could flare up very, very quickly on Europe's doorstep. If there's any kind of migration outflows and so on, that could really become a major crisis. I'm grateful that you brought up Iran. It is mentioned. It is actually identified rather in as a tier one category. And I think the incoming Biden folks have been fairly clear that they want to try to if you will, put Humpty Dumpty back together again on the JCPOA and bring Iran into compliance. And I think they're prepared to negotiate that. You know, a lot's happened since that was negotiated. A lot of blood's been spilled, a lot of, you know, bad feelings generated by what is often characterized as Iran's malign behavior in the region. And so trying to sort of reconcile these different tensions and requirements is going to be a huge task for the Biden folks. And you know, it took a lot of high-level commitment from this team in the Obama administration to bring this issue under control. And the question is, you know, do they have the bandwidth to really focus on this while they're having to do with not just Russia, China, but all these other issues? And we didn't mention Venezuela also. So while this may be something they want to do, it's going to have to take, its place in line here. I think, you know, given Jake Sullivan and Bill Burns's sort of direct interest in this, then I imagine this will be.
And Wendy Sherman.
And Wendy Sherman, yes, thank you.
Edit, who's going to be number two at state. I mean, you know, there are a lot of people who are very invested in the Iran deal who are there, as well as in dealing with North Korea, interestingly.
What's the in that scenario, Carla, what's the timing of it? In other words, I mean, our view is, I think we put 75% that we re-enter this agreement, but that the politics are such that it really is a late 2021 or 2022 decision. A lot of the political volatility revolves around that point. So we've kind of taken the view that this is, if you know, in terms of top risks for 2021, this is less so that.
It was one of your red herrings. You know, the position of the president-elect was, if the Iranians went back to where they were before, which, and you know, they've certainly enriched a lot of, you know, uranium since then, that's going to have to go out of the country again. And so the Iranians are going to have to do certain things, but the Americans are going to have to do certain things, some of which the Congress has involved in. But I mean, there are things that the president can do from an executive order point of view. I mean, I think they're going to want to try to put Humpty Dumpty back together again. But this incoming administration has also said they want to move beyond the deal to deal with the malign activities as well. And there's no sign that the Iranians have ever wanted to expand this deal. And, you know, we'll see if, you know, if the Obama administration had more time, could they have pushed it further? You know, could they have gotten the Europeans involved to pressure the Iranians? You know, has there ever been a sign that the Iranians wanted to behave like a normal state? I've never seen it.
Mm-hmm. Well, good questions.
So more questions from, we have a very high-powered group out there who are not asking questions. So if you don't watch out, I'm going to behave like the professor I am and call on the people I know out there. Doug Olivet, you must have a question. Oh, I see. There are more questions. People got nervous that I was going to call.
You shamed them, Carla.
Larry Cantor. I think you can unmute yourself, or you will be unmuted. So if you could ask your question, it'd be great. Thank you.
Can you hear me now?
Absolutely.
Yeah, hi. It's Larry Cantor. I'm an operating partner at Atlas Merchant Capital. This is just in reference to this idea that there's some kind of disconnect between the financial markets and what's been going on in terms of the slow rollout of the vaccine, all the turmoil around, the election and so forth. And that is that I think it might reflect an underappreciation of just how big the stimulus has been, which was referred to. And this is really an issue of timing, because it's pretty clear that excesses are being built up and they'll be corrected at some point. But the idea that this is going to happen in the next 6 to 9 months just seems to me to be somewhat far-fetched. So just to give you an example, so during the financial crisis, the Fed did expanded its balance sheet by about $3.5 trillion over 5.5 years. They did $3 trillion over 3 months. On the fiscal side, the fiscal stimulus has been about 5 times what it was during the Obama administration during the financial crisis. Just to give you an example, between February and April, personal income, government transfers to households went up by over $3 trillion. This is 15% of GDP, and personal income by April was well above what it was before the pandemic, and we've now got a saving rate over 13%. Not only that, but more is coming. So we've done another $900 billion. I'm not arguing that this is necessary. We have a K-shaped recovery, as you said, and there's probably going to be even more. The Fed is buying $120 billion a month, even with the increase in asset prices, both stocks, houses, and so forth, which is going to create a wealth effect. So it's very hard, I think, when you understand just how big. And don't forget that in the financial crisis, after that fiscal stimulus, fiscal policy actually tightened, and we're getting further stimulus there. So this is, yes, it's bloating things. And I think even the gentleman who talked about this said these things always turn out to be bigger, the crises, but they always happen later than you think. So I don't think there's a disconnect here. I think you can easily explain why the financial markets are behaving as they are. And don't forget, even with the backup in treasury yields, you're talking about 10-year treasuries at about 1%. So, you know, my point is, yes, we'll pay for this. There's no free lunch. But I would say, at least before sort of the latter part of this year, it's hard to see it.
I mostly agree with you, Larry, on especially on your point underappreciating the scale of the stimulus, and even the elections in Georgia led us to materially up our view on what we're going to get from U.S. Congress this year, right? And these things, an extra percent of GDP or so. So that does matter. The question is, what countries, if not the U.S., what countries are out there where sustainability concerns could come to the fore this year, right? Where you say, basically, this country can't handle it. And the ones I mentioned, I think, are on my list, but there probably are others. I think your point on the, on what the Fed's doing is very important. It's a fascinating debate in miniature, right? Because how does contagion work, right? If we did get some sort of emerging crisis in developing countries, would it cascade back through a shift in risk appetite? Well, if the Fed says basically, no, we're not going to let the yield curve rise, that short circuits to some extent that transmission mechanism. That's not quite what they're saying, right? They're saying we're going to continue to buy what we've been buying. We're not concerned if the rise in yields reflects growth, but if it reflected some pullback in risk appetite, would they move to some version of basically trying to control the yield curve? That's what markets are so sensitive to, but that's very much critical in my view to this contagion debate as well. I'm not sure what you think about that.
Did you want Larry to respond to that, or should
Larry wants to come back on it. I know he deals with it on a daily basis.
I think we should move on.
I don't know. I mean, it's a very good question. I think even in the U.S. you're going to pay for this. I mean, you know, at some point they're going to have to tighten fiscal policy quite a bit. And we will get excessive valuations if we don't already have them. I think you could point to some. I'm just saying this is going to go on for a while. That's my point. It's more of a timing thing. And I think on the contagion issue, obviously, which market is critical? China does not look like at this point there's going to be any economic problem at all. In fact, they're so well placed because they're such big exporters of manufacturing goods. And as you know, there's been a boom in goods spending. So if it's not China, if it's not Brazil, if it's not Mexico, and if it's not India, I'd see the chances for that kind of contagions that could really undermine U.S. financial markets is very slim. I guess that's what I'd say. If it's one of those four countries, I think we're in trouble. But if it's not, I kind of doubt that that's going to topple things.
Thanks. Yeah. That's really useful. Christine Cumming.
Yes, thank you. I'm from Columbia SEPA. Something that's occurred since you compiled your survey, of course, is the emergence of these, the visibility of these white supremacist and nationalist groups here in the United States. And you do have the concern on your relatively high on your list about a mass terror attack from a foreign terrorist organization. Do you have any sense that there could be crossover or collaboration with domestic, or is that, you know, a bridge too far at this point?
I'm not really qualified to discuss that. I think there are plenty of reasons to be worried about extreme right-wing white supremacist groups carrying out mass casualty attacks on their own without foreign influence. So I don't think, you know, it requires some support from abroad to be qualify as a source of serious concern. Just to be clear, you know, every year when we solicit suggestions for the survey, we're certainly in recent years, we've been inundated with folks who have pointed to this problem and the risk of major unrest. And frankly, we can't ignore it, but at the same time, this survey is very much focused on foreign crises but it makes it difficult for us every year to sort of almost willfully ignore the fact that so many folks who are suggesting what should be on the survey are talking about civil unrest in the U.S. It's obviously very upsetting too. As for your specific question, I really can't make a judgment on that.
Although, you know, Paul, I did wonder about this, which was number one on the top risks report is 46 with an asterisk. And it makes the argument that the perceived that if half of the country, or slightly less than half of the country, and so many legislators argue that the President of the United States was illegitimately elected, it will potentially limit President Biden's ability to solve problems at home, but also limit his ability to lead abroad. Yep. And that does have an impact on preventive priorities. So one does wonder if perhaps next year, depending on how things play out, if we need to start thinking about certainly other countries, if other countries going to do a survey like that, you know, a weakened United States might be on the list of concerns, no?
Absolutely. And this is a tension that folks in the intelligence community have been grappling with for many years about to the extent to which U.S. actions and conditions in the U.S. should be part of their own assessment that they give to the president. And, you know, I'm not sure they've come up with some resolution to that dilemma, but I agree. I think this is something that is probably unsustainable if we continue on the course that we're on at the moment.
It's a very depressing thought. So Doug Ollivant, who my dear friend who I called on, has now jumped into the fray. Doug, thank you. Doug has his hands up. Can someone unmute him? Yes, thank you.
Can you hear me now?
Hey, Doug.
Hey, Carla. Thanks for calling me out. You know, you gave me very few options here.
not the first time, won't be the last.
I'll ask a follow-up to what we just had. Not so much, you know, terrorism events writ large inside the United States, but continuing low-grade violence. You know, it's not hard to picture areas in the rural United States where you have a conformity of belief that the election is illegitimate, where local law enforcement is sympathetic to those views that can be used as a base against perhaps a, you know, NBC affiliate if you don't like the MSNBC talking points. You know, how concerned should we be about this? You know, we can think about the, you know, Nashville and the extraordinary effect it had on American infrastructure for about 3 days. How should we think about this, both in terms of the possibility of violence, and then what are the economic effects? And I guess as a follow on, how does it affect our foreign policy? You know, the Onion wig, you know, had their piece on Serbian peacekeepers coming to Washington, D.C. I've been getting emails from Iraqis asking us if we need help with track two. You know, how does it affect us as we face the world?
Rob, what are you hearing from your clients? You have clients all over the world.
In terms of the economic consequences of that, of this risk, you mean, or just in terms of
the perceived instability in the United States?
Yeah. You know? Oh, that part of it. Yeah, no, absolutely. I think that, you know, and you know, we've been, for those of us who those of you who know us, we've been very much focused, Ian Bremmer's been very much focused on this idea of a G0 world, even before the pandemic and these most recent threats emerged. This is an extraordinary intensification of those kind of concerns. And you're right, I mean, I appreciated you giving the shout out to the fact that really for the second year running, our top risk is US-based. Last year about the acceptance of the election, now about the ability to govern going forward. And absolutely the ability of the US to lead. You talked about the domestic, the international political element, there's an international economic element. Is there a kind of committee to save the world in the context of a G20 effort to address the kind of concerns that I have? And we have real doubts whether that can mobilize in the current context. But there's also to this economic point, I think that's quite interesting, is this is a kind of risk that has particularly strong effects on trusted networks, right? And that sort of affects internationally active corporations. The risk that a domestic terrorist incident takes out, you know, telecom in your area, right? The fact that you can't mobilize an effective response to a hacking threat that means that you can't trust your downloads, right, as being safe. These have strong economic externalities, if you will, by affecting your capacity to trust your supply chains and your networks in that environment. I mean, and so I do think the potential for this to be disruptive. And then there's just sort of these bigger, broader political questions, you know, what's gonna, this sort of deglobalization debate that's going on, where will the US end up? What is US policy on whether on national champions, on supply chains, on tech relationships and information with China? And all of these things get paralyzed to some extent, I think, by the forces we're talking about here.
If I could just add very quickly to, in response to Doug's question, I think, you know, looking at this, you can point to sort of three issues that where domestic unrest affects our foreign policy. One, obviously, is that foreign adversaries could increasingly exploit various movements and create agitation and just to distract us and moreover do things while we're focusing on this. So that's clearly one. It obviously undercuts our ability to focus on other issues. The more we're addressing these domestic issues, the less time we have for other ones. It's just a straight opportunity cost. And thirdly, there's the issue that many have pointed to, that it just makes it very difficult to operate from a kind of moral high ground or project any sense that we have a better way of things, a better way of doing things that others can emulate, whether it's, you know, our political system or our economic system. And all this impacts, obviously, foreign policy issues in all kinds of ways.
I mean, the credibility, even, you know, this whole debate about whether or not it's, you know, President Biden should convene a, you know, a democracy summit and whether we have the right to sit at the head of the table. And that's, to me, I mean, I am such a believer that the United States still is, you know, a shining city. It depresses me when I see all the people pushing back against that. And after the last week, I see that. Guillermo Christensen, please.
Thank you very much. Guillermo Christensen, a partner at Ice Miller and former CIA, and actually one of the plank owners, if you will, of the CPA many, many moons ago at the council when I was a CIA fellow. Very quick question. If you were looking at the next 4 years under President Biden and reflecting that the last 4 years have been very uncertain for our adversaries, whether it's the Chinese or the Russians, how would you view their sense of opportunities to heighten their advantage and obviously cause U.S. risk to go up across the issues that you've listed or maybe others? If you're writing, you know, an opportunity analysis for Putin, for example, and they know a lot about the Biden team, obviously, where are they going to hammer on first? And the same thing for the Chinese.
And we have one more question, which I'm going to, just because we have such a limited amount of time, I'm just going to, if Stephen Del Rosa wouldn't mind doing the question really fast, and then we'll throw it to Rob and Paul.
Yeah, thanks. I'll be very quick with the Carnegie Corporation. If the U.S. botches and its allies botches the rollout of the vaccine in their own countries, never mind globally, and by contrast, the Chinese do much better globally, what are the implications geopolitically? Obviously, it's a longer term, but into 2021.
Great question. Thanks, both of you.
So maybe I should take a crack at Guillermo's and maybe Rob at Steve's. So Guillermo, excellent question. It touches on, frankly, what we were just saying earlier, that you know, the more domestic unrest in the U.S., you know, the more opportunities there are for China and Russia and other countries to do mischief, to take actions while we're focused on others. You know, I think it's no accident that we saw the crackdown on Hong Kong take place right in the midst of much of this. And I think, as Carla said, she wouldn't be surprised if Putin does something in the next week, 10 days too, that while we are again consumed by, what's happening internally here. So, you know, if I'm doing the opportunity analysis for Xi Jinping or Putin, then, you know, our Achilles heel is that we have this sort of commitments in the Middle East, and it's very hard for us to extract ourselves from the Middle East, given our longstanding commitments there and keeping us distracted there and bogged down there. You know, it's from their perspective, that reduces the pressure on them, whether it's China may have a plan for South China Sea or Taiwan or so on, or for Putin in Belarus and so on. So that's kind of how I would do it, think of it, if I were both of them.
Thanks. Ron, fast.
The vaccine competition, it's a potential positive for the Chinese to repair a little bit their reputation that I think has been damaged in the last year. But it's not an easy path forward. I think the battleground becomes a lot of emerging markets, particularly in Africa, but also in Latin America. I think that's going to create a lot of tension with the U.S. Because of this sort of new expanded Chinese role. You also, I think, will see the similar competition on information and on data. And as I mentioned earlier, this evolving debate on the extent to which national security is a reason for protectionism.
Well, thank you both. Thank Rob, Paul, and to our participants today who asked great questions after a little bit of pressure. Thank you, Doug, for jumping in there when I called you. This has been a great conversation. The Preventive Priority Survey is now out. It's in chat. Paul, where they can find it on the council website, yes?
That's correct, yes. And I believe you did embed the link in this chat too.
And Rob, they can find the top risk survey on the Eurasia Group website and on G0 as well, I think. It's been a fabulous conversation. And thank you so much for joining us all today.
Thanks, Krista.
Bye.
Bye.